Hello, everyone. I'm Chris Mintz. This is Jonathan Pugh. We're associate pastors here at Venture Church, and we've got a couple of great announcements for you. Jonathan?
So we have life groups for all ages, meeting all different types of the week, and they're going to be meeting weekly beginning September 13th. Some meet more than just for 4 weeks, but some will just be meeting for 4 weeks. And we meet on Sunday through Thursday. There's a group every single day of those weeks. So there's likely one that can meet your schedule. Some of them will be online for those of you who still can't make it work to meet in person. But one of the things we're going to be talking about is what we're talking about in our sermon. What's the second coming of the Lord going to look like? And so that's always interesting. That's always good to hear different viewpoints, but also more importantly, to find out what does our view of the second coming have to do with our life here and now. So I encourage you, no matter what age you are, no matter who you are, contact me at jonathan.pugh@daretoventure.org. You can call me here at the church, or you can use the next steps button on daretoventure.org website, and I will find a group that will suit you. I hope pretty confident that we can do that.
Awesome. Also, regarding life groups, our students are coming back to the Hub on Wednesday, September 9th from 6:30 to 8. We're going to have food, we'll have hangout time, and we'll jump into the prior Sunday's sermon message as well. So we're inviting all middle school and high school students to come out and join us. Check out our social media outlets for more information and the details regarding that. Thanks, guys, and we look forward to seeing everyone back in the groups.
Welcome. Thank you guys for coming out to worship with us. Just a couple of notes. If you're new to Venture, please stop by the red tent. We brought it inside because of the heat, and we'd love to meet you and hear your story. Also, you can go to daretoventure.org. We have a new to Venture link that you can tab there and send your information to us that way. Also, if you are interested in joining one of the life groups that are kicking back up here soon, or our student ministry, or if you just need help with your next steps in your faith, please stop by the Next Steps room. We'll have pastors over there. I'd love to talk to you, hear your story. Also, there's a Next Steps tab at daretoventure.org. Use that, and we'll be in contact as well. And last thing, financial support. Our tithing and gifts are very important to maintain our ministries and to grow those ministries during a crazy, chaotic time. So it's very vital that we continue to give generously to the church so we can move those ministries forward. So we thank you for that. Let's pray. Well, Lord God, thank you so much for this time of worship. God, lift us up. Change us with your word. God, thank you so much for an opportunity to sit here, stand here, sing a song about your love, your grace, the power of the gospel. God, thank you so much for who you are, and thank you for your son. In your name we pray. Amen. Guys, please stand. Let's worship together.
I'm washed, I'm drenched in love. priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Thank you.
Amen. That's good. Let's pray. Father, what a blessing it is to sing songs like that. Lord, you are so good to us. God, what an amazing thing that you would give us life through your own Son so that we sinners could know you. Man. Father, I pray now as we hear your word, Lord, Father, that you would grow us. Father, draw us to yourself. Help us to boldly proclaim your gospel. Grow us in the knowledge and the wisdom of who you are. God, I pray that a song that we just sang like that, Father, would not just be something that we sing here. Father, that it would be the cry and the desire of our hearts when we wake up each morning. God, in the good times and the bad times and the struggle, Father, you are there and you are working. Father, be with us now as Austin brings your word. Father, it's in your beautiful name I pray. Amen.
Wow, man. What an appropriate song for where we're going to be this week and next week, because we have our series called This Is Living. If you're listening on YouTube or Facebook, or watching, I guess, on YouTube or Facebook, or maybe you're listening on iTunes, welcome to our online worship gathering. We're so glad you joined us. And by us, it's not just me here in our band, but there's people here in our building. We record this every Sunday on every Wednesday. We record our Sunday on Wednesday at 7 o'clock at night. And so, hey, to those over in the kid zone, it was so cool seeing you coming in there. And to my little girl sitting in there as well. So, hey, I'm just glad to worship with everybody here this morning. And particularly this morning, this afternoon, tonight, whatever it is. I don't know when it is, man. I'm like wide open. But we're studying something that is heavy, all right? Really heavy this week and next week. At least the context of the subject is, because what we're going to find in this, what we're going to see, is not heavy at all. It's glorious, but it's in the context of something heavy. What is that? Death. You're going to die. Now, I know some of y'all are young, and you might not really realize that, but it is 100% guaranteed you're going to die. Even more morbid, people you love are going to die. Matter of fact, everybody you love is going to die. Some will die before you. Some will die after you. Death is a constant reality of our life. It is a total unavoidable reality of our life. And the older you get, the more you realize that. Amen? Those who got some birthdays in here, I can point, you know, but who might be the oldest, but I'm just saying, the older you get, maybe sitting up here. But the older you get, the more the reality that death is coming becomes a part of your experience. And, you know, it's a good thing. It can make you live wiser. You start realizing I got less time. I need to make smarter decisions. I don't have as long to draw them out. But it can also become a heavy weight that burdens people and robs them of life. I mean, how are you supposed to live if you know the people you love most are going to die? How are you supposed to live if people you love have already gone? How are you supposed to live knowing that tomorrow may be my last day on this earth? Like, how do we live not like breathing and our heart beating, but how do we really embrace and enjoy life in this? And so Paul is writing to the church in Thessalonica. He's talking to them about real life, eternal living, the only thing that's found in Christ. And he's going to deal with this subject. It's heavy and it's hard, but he's going to deal with it in an awesome way. So I know you just sat down, but I'm going to invite you to... Wow, there goes my chapstick, man. I got it. All right, so those of you on YouTube, it's a chapstick commercial. Maybe you can send us some money, chapstick. All right, so there we go. All right, what do we got here? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. Could you stand with me as we read God's word? He says, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with the cry of the command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. God, I pray, Father, for those listening online. I pray for those here tonight. God, I pray for those Sunday. Lord, I pray that you would encourage us. The very words we just sang about your goodness. God, they get clouded out and we lose faith and we lose sight of living. All too often when death becomes very clear for what it is. And so, Lord, today I pray that you would encourage us and give us real hope. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys can be seated. So, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, they create an understanding for us on how we can have real hope. Everybody say, real hope. Real hope. Well, that went bad. That went bad for Wednesday night. Y'all been to work all day, all right? So, real hope, all right? What's the first reason Paul gives on how we can have real hope in the face of death, the reality of both our loved ones and ourselves? How do we have that? Well, number one, Christians can hope, have real hope, because Christ's resurrection proves there is life beyond the grave, all right? So we can have real hope because Christ's resurrection proves we can have life beyond the grave. He says in verse 13, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who've fallen asleep. So he goes, look, I don't want you to be worried here about death, okay? Particularly, he's speaking because there, I believe in Thessalonica, there were those who were really genuinely confused about the gospel. He says, we don't want you to be uninformed. You're ignorant about some things. And where ignorance appears, it generally gets filled by religious superstition, all right? So where we don't know real gospel, the world offers its alternative, and that's generally some religious superstition nonsense, right? So there's a lot of theories over what they were believing in Thessalonica, but the bottom line is they have become very uninformed about what happens to people who die. I love what Paul says here, too, by the way. He says they fell asleep. Now, some use this as a verse, it's a doctrine called soul sleep, that when you die, you're really not present with the Lord, you're just kind of in like some middle ground, and you really don't, you know, like, I'm probably going to have a shoulder surgery this year, you know, and put you to sleep, you wake up, you don't even know what happened, you know. So a lot of people view biblical death that way. That's not what he's saying. He's speaking of the body that's asleep, and very clearly Paul has said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. The body is not done away with, it is not gone, it is not eradicated, it's asleep, and it's going to be raised from the dead, as we're going to see here in this passage. But he says, I don't want you to be uninformed. He says, so it goes here, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. I don't want you to grieve in a way like people who don't have any hope. Now notice he doesn't say, I don't want you to grieve. Did you catch that? A lot of times this is what's communicated. If you're a Christian, bless God, you ought not even be grieving. That's nowhere in the New Testament. That's not even old. That's nowhere. He says that you may not grieve as others do. In Greek society, and in our society today, it's very similar. There were people who grieved death with hysteria. You've probably seen in your own life, this absolute hysteria. If you have no hope, then death is certainly going to cause some hysteria. I mean, ain't nobody other than Jesus been there and come back to talk about it. Whether it was Lazarus, but he died before he got to write anything down, you know what I mean? But I don't know anybody that's, now we have the people that saw the light, you know, and we've all maybe, everybody knows somebody that has one of those. Maybe you don't, but a lot of us do. We know someone that's had these near-death experiences. But no one's ever, like, literally walked around heaven, introduced himself to Jesus, wrote all the stuff down, come back, talked about it, other than Paul had a vision of it, John has a vision of it, but nobody we know. All right, you get my point? All right, so people generally, if you have no hope in the gospel and you don't know this, you're going to be quite hysterical about this unknown. You know what I mean? General panic. Lights go out in your house. You don't know why. There's a little bit of panic. That's why I got a gun. And I'm walking around my house with a flashlight. What's going on? Why did I hear this weird noise? You know, not everything. I'm not that paranoid. But my point is, that's how people view death. Or they treat death this way. They were called Stoic philosophers in the first century. It still happens today. You just act like, well, it's no big deal. Atheists are very popular in just saying, look, everybody's going to die. It's reality for everybody. So there's no sense worrying about it. Everybody's going to die, so just forget about it. That's a very popular argument among atheists. So you just suppress. So there's hysteria in how you view death, and then there's suppression in how you view death. Well, it just happens to everybody, so it's no big deal. The Greeks were even guilty of being quite sexist about it. The Greeks would say, to the men and to the soldiers, don't act like a woman and cry about this. Be a man. Suppress. And what suppression does is it drives it down deep where you don't realize it's destroying you. So the world responds to death with hysteria and suppression. He says, I don't want you to do that. I want you to know how to grieve differently. I don't want you to grieve as those who don't have hope, who don't know what's coming. I want you to grieve differently. How do we do that? Well, he says, for since, verse 14, for since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. So we know that Jesus Christ died and rose again. If you're a Christian, you know that. All right? If you're a Christian and you don't know that, then let me let you know something else. You're actually not a Christian. All right? So Christianity is based on the belief that Christ died and rose again. And if you don't believe that Christ rose again, you are not saved. You're not a Christian. You understand that? That is like fundamentally not the gospel if you don't believe Christ rose again. So he says to the Christians, we believe that Jesus died and rose again. By the very concept that he rose again, we're saying there is life after death. If he was placed in a grave and died, and the people are right that death is the mitigation of life, it's over, it's done away with, it's put away with, it doesn't exist anymore, then Christ's resurrection proves that wrong. There is life after death. So we know that. But then he goes even further in this. He says, for since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and then he goes on, even so, all right, so because of this, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. What is he getting at here? Well, the Father did not abandon the Son. The Son died. God didn't leave him in the grave. He rose. There was life after death. It's real. He says, in the same way that the Father did not abandon the Son to the grave, the Father will not abandon us to the grave. This is what he's getting at. Why will the Father not abandon us? Where is the hope that attaches me to that? That's the gospel. Because through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have been adopted as his children. Okay? Fathers don't leave their kids to die. Do you understand this? So the Father rose the Son. He rose the Son from the grave. I need help. Okay, so I was looking at the interpreter, see if she could help me out. All right, so... But the Father did this to the Son. In the same manner, the same commitment, no less than the Father was committed to the eternal Son, is the Father committed to you and I that he has adopted as his children. The hope of the gospel is not that we are lost sinners with the ticket. The hope of the gospel is that through the work of Christ on Calvary, we have literally been adopted into the household of God. You have the last name of God forever. His blood is in your veins. His robes are on your body. You belong to him forever. That is the goodness of God. And so we have that hope. If I'm with him, then I will always be with him. Romans chapter 8, even in death, we are still with him. His active, real, tangible, felt love that is alive and doing something cannot even be ended in our death, according to Romans chapter 8. So the first thing that Paul has to say here, the first reason is that because Christ is alive, we can have real hope. We can grieve differently than those who grieve with hysteria or suppression. Now, the second reason Paul gives is that Christians can hope because Christ's return guarantees our future is indescribably glorious. All right? This was one of the... I had a hard time wording this point because I just couldn't come up with words I just felt were good enough. You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, how do I describe this? Okay? When we look at death, the reality of those that we love will die, the reality that we will die, where do we find hope? It is in the promise, ultimately, in the promise of the return of Christ. Watch what he says. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord. In other words, this is just emphasizing the fact that Jesus himself made this really, really clear. Just read the Gospels. That we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. All right? Now, what's going on there? Well, I said it earlier. There was a general worry. Those of you who are really young may not relate to this yet. I know you guys are engaged. I remember that's when it first hit me, when I was getting engaged. I was like, God is going to send Jesus back about the second the pastor says, I now pronounce y'all. You know what I'm saying? Like, Limousine's going to be there. We're going to be heading off to the honeymoon. I've waited 25 years, you know. And then all of a sudden, God's going to show up and rob me of my honeymoon. You know what I'm saying? And I just knew that was going to happen. I was like, they're going to rename Murphy's Law to Olson's Law. Now, what was I experiencing? I was in my mind thinking that there would be a loss somehow. You see, when we face it, even now, as a 46-year-old guy, part of my fear of death is the loss of the experience with my children. Like, I want to see them grow up. I want to see grandkids. I want to see that. And so we fear that there's a loss in this. There were believers at Thessalonica who were worried that in death there would be a loss. I'm going to miss out. Particularly, there was a concept that I'm going to miss out even in the blessings of Christ at his return. Jesus is going to return. I'm going to miss the whole thing. I'm going to be dead. He's going to come back and rule and reign. There's going to be all this awesome stuff when Jesus comes back. You see, many in the first century really believed that Jesus was coming back right then and there. And so when someone died, there was a grievance for them that they were going to miss out on this amazing thing. But there was also some selfish grievance. Like, gosh, man, if I die, look what I'm going to miss. And so Paul's like, let me confirm. You ain't missing nothing. All right? You're not missing nothing. He says, for it's in his return that the dead are going to rise first. We ought to see. You don't need to worry about this. Those who are alive or left at the coming of the Lord will not precede those who've fallen asleep. There's something he's going to do. So look at verse 16. He says, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with the cry of a command. Now, this is some really cool, like, metaphoric language here. A lot of people get hung up on the specifics and miss the point. This is prophetic language that is meant to describe the awesomeness and grandeur of an event. All right? That's what we're supposed to be like, wow. All right, so these are terms. These are like halftime coach's speech, get you fired up to go back out there and win the game kind of words. Y'all with me? All right. So he goes, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with the cry of a command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise. Now, these little metaphors are really cool. All right. So he goes, the cry of a command, pointing to the grandeur and awesomeness of the one who's coming and what he's coming to do. Cry of a command. I was watching a horse race the other week, a couple weeks ago, and I was bored. I got my Hulu, and I was trying to find something sports. I'm like many guys. I'm like dying to watch somebody compete in something. So I couldn't find a person. I found some horses. And I was like, all right, I'll watch the horses race. Now, there's probably some, you know, out there in cyberspace somewhere. It's like, oh, those horse races, they aren't fair to the horses. I'll have you know, I was involved with horses for a little while in grad school. Man, the excitement on a horse loves to run. Right? They would literally run themselves to death. They love to run so much. All right. So here comes these horses, man, and they are like wound up. If you ever watch a horse race, they actually have somebody who has to walk the horse to the gate. All right. Otherwise, the poor guy on the horse, they don't stand a chance because the horse is just gone. All right. That horse can't wait. It's so excited. And so they get these horses into the gate. And they don't stay in that gate long, because if they stay in that gate long, that poor rider's going to get killed, all right? That horse is wound out and can't wait for what? Go. Go. All right, so Paul's going that same language here, all right, of that runner ready to go, of that soldier waiting on the cry to go to battle. They know they're going to win. He says, you and I as Christians, the Lord himself is going to descend in this manner. He is standing at the gate, ready to go. Jesus is ready to roll. The church is supposed to be saying, Maranatha, come Lord Jesus, let's go. And then he's going to give the command. And the burst of the crowd when them horses came out was just amazing. The burst of the crowd when the race began, when the horse finally, boom, took off. The horse was excited. The crowd was excited. The body of Christ is going to be eternally even greater. He says, so with the cry of the command, with the voice of an archangel. Now, I read all these people trying to say, which angel it was. You know, well, it's this angel. Well, it's that angel. Well, the other angel. Paul's point was clearly not to point to an angel. Matter of fact, he says the voice of man, not thee. You see that? There's not a thee in here, because who the angel is a ridiculous conversation to have. Who the angel is doesn't matter. The point is he is not being announced as a normal king would be announced by a human who comes out and proclaims he's coming. Because he's not just human. He is the God-man. The return of Christ is not a return of a teacher or a philosopher or a political hero. The return of Christ is the return of the King of the universe who spoke everything into creation. And so it is a non-human entity that proclaims the eternal God is coming back. So with the cry of a command, with the voice of an archangel, I keep wanting to say arch. I've been in Gaston County 18 years. I should have an excuse, all right? The voice of an archangel and with the sound of the trumpet of God. Now, I love this metaphor here, all right? Now, in the first century, people didn't play trumpets for entertainment. All right, you didn't go hear a trumpet concert. It wasn't a part of a deal, all right? So trumpets were used for proclamations of dignitaries. Trumpets were used in battle to arrange and call and give out orders based on the certain trumpet sound. The soldiers would know they're supposed to do X, Y, Z maneuver. It would sound the cry for retreat. It would sound the cry for advancement, right? So it was used to communicate. But one of the interesting things in the first century, in the early days, the Romans would use it to announce the death of a ruler. Matter of fact, when Claudius died, historians wrote that the trumpets were so loud, they thought the emperor's trumpeters were trying to communicate to the dead that Claudius was actually dead because it was so loud. It so dominated the city, this sound. The interesting part is everywhere when you look in antiquity, trumpets are normally associated with somebody dying or getting ready to die. Like, burr, go kill the enemy. Or, burr, you better run because y'all about to die. It was always associated with somebody's about to die. Now, in the Old Testament, we certainly see the trumpet of God. They surround Jericho and march. They blow the horns. Walls fall down. So we see it in a military use in the Bible as well. But it's really interesting. The trumpet of God here is not a sound of destruction. It's not a sound of fear. It's not a sound for the church to tremble. It's a sound for the church to jump. Life is coming. The cry of the command to go. The archangel saying, God is returning. And the sound of the trumpet is emphasizing the king is coming home. Life is moving in. Our hope in the gospel is happening right in front of us. And he said, and the dead in Christ will rise first. The promise of the gospel is going to happen. And it's going to happen in an amazing, marvelous, awesome, incredible way. And then he says in verse 17, then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So we will always be with the Lord. Now, again, there's some awesome imagery here. Ephesians chapter 2. Paul spoke of the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that's now at work among us, and those who are disobedient. All right? Associating Satan and satanic elements as the ruler of the prince of the air. It's interesting that the metaphor of the return of Christ is that he appears in the air. There's an incredible symbolism there that at the coming of Christ, Satan is defeated. At his simple coming, he's defeated. The gathering point of the body with Jesus is in the air, where the Bible uses this metaphor of the language of how Satan and demonic forces rule over the earth. Jesus first appears where God has cursed the earth to be ruled by Satan to remove him from where he is. Now, the other side of this is language that, frankly, it took me a lot of years in my life to get to the place that I first was willing to accept it, and then I completely adopted it. And I just want you to know what I'm about to say, and some of you online, you're probably already coming, oh, you're heathen, you're pagan, I know where you're going with this, all right? I grew up being told about the coming of Christ, that there was going to be this trumpet. I love the story of Chris Mintz. Chris Mintz tells a story. He grew up in a Pentecostal church, and, you know, they were always time blowing this big shofar thing, and one day Jesus was going to blow the shofar, and everybody that was a Christian was going to disappear. You know, planes are going to fall out of the sky, trains going to run off rails, cars, boom, running, everything, because Christians just, whoop, gone, you know, that there's really, the Bible speaks of a second coming of Christ, but I was always really confused because there seemed to be like, in the church, there seemed to be two teachings. So there was like a second and a third, but I couldn't find a third. But the Bible's teaching about a second and third, like Jesus was going to come and all Christians were going to disappear. And then he was going to come back later and we were all going to reappear. This is one of those passages that's ironically used to defend. It's called a pre-tribulation rapture. I bought into that most of my life. Now listen, if you believe that, look, I'm cool with it. We believe Jesus is coming back. Amen? But here's the encouragement of this passage. Chris Mintz said, the point of that Chris Mintz story was, he was outside one day, some dude up the road was practicing his trumpet, blew his trumpet, and Chris about passed out. because he was still there. And so he's like, oh my gosh, I didn't go! You know, and so he freaked out, you know. And so many Christians see this as some horrible, like, scary thing. It's not a scary thing. When it comes to the tribulation, Jesus had a lot to say to the church, by the way, on how we to endure the great tribulation. The Bible talks about us being in the tribulation. The book of Revelation is written to encourage the church with the assumption that we're going to be in the tribulation. So the rapture concept that the church is going to leave before the tribulation, there are people who are much smarter than me who teach that, incredibly smarter than me. So I respect the argument. I just don't agree with it. And this passage is one of those why I don't. The language used here is of the same language that Josephus used, the same exact words that Josephus used when he spoke of Alexander the Great, recorded Alexander the Great coming to Jerusalem. When he came to Jerusalem, the people in the city ran out to Jerusalem to gather with him, not so they'd leave with Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great was coming to the city of Jerusalem. Jesus is coming to earth. It's called the second coming. All right. So when he says we have this to look forward to, when the dead in Christ are going to rise, when we're going to meet him in the air, he is coming. And we are going to go out of this city, just like they do when any other dignitary comes to the city to blow the trumpets. Everybody's like, oh, look, they run out, they greet them, and then they come into the city. The dignitary is not coming to take people from the city. He's coming to bring his people into the city. When the trumpets sound in the Old Testament, it was a gathering of the body of Christ. It was a gathering of the church. And so the trumpet sounds, the church gathers. Why? Because the hope of the gospel is the earth restored. And when Jesus comes back, that's our hope. That's why Paul said, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. He said, come, Lord Jesus, because when he returns, Satan is gone. When he returns, the principalities of this world are gone. When he returns, we will rule and reign with him. God's destiny for you and I is not some place out past the stars. It's here. God made the earth to dwell with man. Man's sin separated man from God. The cross restores man to God, and it restores the earth as the dwelling place of God with man. The promise of the gospel is that he is restoring all things. He is making all things new. Our hope is not in some foreign planet. Our hope is the Jesus who splits the sky and brings his glory to this earth. That's our future. And those who are dead will rise first. Those who are dead ain't going to miss out on anything. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And the miracle of Christ returning is those who will be resurrected first, as Jesus was resurrected, are those who are already with him. And like, how cool is that? We're going to be up in heaven walking around, and all of a sudden the Father's going to be like, time to go. And we'll be like, sweet. And in an instant, all of a sudden, the body is resurrected. We appear in the sky. Our brothers and sisters who are alive are with us. And we descend on this earth. Satan is destroyed. Jesus reigns. And for all of eternity, the promise of the gospel of his children with him and each of us with one another is live forever. That's heaven. That's the promise. And so we don't have some random stoic suppressed thing. We don't have some be hysterical and hope it works out like you hope the lottery, you know, you're going to win the lottery. We have an ascended king. He didn't just die and rise from the grave, but he ascended. And the Bible says if he ascended, he will descend. There is no mystery in where he went, and therefore there is no mystery in where he's going to be. Now, the third reason Paul gives on why we can live with real hope. It's in the resurrection, it's in his return, and it's in this mutual encouragement that we can do with one another. Christians can hope because we have a future to encourage one another with. We can hope because we can be bound together. It's hard to hope by yourself. Listen, I'm not knocking any of those who are listening online. I'm so glad you joined us. Matter of fact, I had lunch with a guy today. His wife has an immune disorder. It's really not a good idea for her to be around people right now. So listen, I'm not knocking anybody. I love to meet. What we want you to do is tell us who you are. We want to be able to be a part of your life as you worship with us online, wherever you might be. So if you're listening right now, then press pause, go over to daretoventure.org, and click that I'm new here. Tell us who you are so we can pray for you, be a part of your life, welcome you into the body. All right, that's my little commercial. But there is power in us. I mean, there's just a power in us. So he didn't give us this to try to find hope by ourselves. When you're by yourself, there's a hopelessness in that altogether. The body of Christ is in us, but it's not just an us based on a politician or a pastor or a denomination or a tradition, because that's where my grandparents went. The body of Christ is in us held together by a promise. A promise that is testified by the birth of a child in a manger who grew up and lived a perfect life because he was God in the flesh. He died on a cross, paid the penalty of our sin, rose from the grave, ascended, and is coming back. That's our promise. He says, therefore, encourage one another with these words. Man, listen, I've got a bond with my teammates from playing football. We had a bond from playing a sport together. If I can have a bond and a sense of unity with guys that were trying to accomplish a game, but I now got to have another surgery because of, that worked out real well, right? If I can, you know, have this sense of real brotherhood, I mean, it's real too. Go slap one of my old teammates, see what I do about it. You know what I mean? Like, let's see, I ain't going to make no biblical promise that I'm going to turn the other cheek. You hit his cheek. You hit mine. Now I'm going to turn yours. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's a brotherhood in that. If I can have that sense of brotherhood with someone that was bound to win a game together, what should we have within the church? We're not competing for a football game. We're not competing for a political contest in November. If your church is marked by a donkey or an elephant, you got the wrong mark. If your church is marked by the favored last names of the people in the church, y'all know what I'm talking about if you grew up in church, you got the wrong mark. If your church is marked by, we are unified and doing things the way that our great-grandparents did it, got the wrong mark. But when you're unified in the hope of the gospel, then you're unified in something that there are no words to describe the awesomeness and the grandeur and the glory and the power and the majesty. And there are no words to describe the relevancy, because every one of us is going to face death. And the gospel gives us hope in something that there is no hope in. And so he says, encourage one another with this. That's why we gather on Sundays. That's why I ask our band to sing songs that make sense to your heart and get you excited about what? This, the gospel. Because every day you live is another day you're going to have to face the reality that you're going to die, and so is everybody else around you. So how do we live? How do we live with hope and passion and energy? Encourage one another with these words. The bond of the church is like no other. But sadly, there are few churches in America that have that bond. We won't really commit to one another. Venture, that's us. We're not very committed to one another. I'm not saying we get an F, but I think about all we got is a D. And I got in trouble if I came home with a D. Encourage one another with this. Be the body. Get plugged in with some other people in the church. And encourage one another with this truth. So here's a challenge I want to give you, and we're done. How are you handling this? Now we're gonna delve into a whole other angle on how we find life in the face of death next week. But I just want to stop where we are this morning, and this afternoon, or evening, or night, or wherever it is you're listening to this. All right. So, are you paralyzed? Paralyzed is what happens when you have hysteria. Paralyzed.
You can't move. Is your life paralyzed in the fear of death? Are you ignoring the reality of death, suppressing it? Is that how you're dealing with it? You've lost a loved one. You've lost someone dear to you, a child, a parent. The reality of everybody you love is going to die either before or after you is in your life right now because you're experiencing it. Are you reacting in hysteria? Or are you reacting in just suppression? You see, what happens when we suppress stuff like that is those things are, those feelings, they wreck us. As Christians, they wreck us. That's why we have tears. That's why it hurts. But if you take something like that and you suppress it and you just shove it down and cover it up and act like it don't happen, act like I'm fine, just push on with life, what doesn't really matter, everybody's going to die, I don't have to deal with this, I don't need to grieve, then what you just did is you took a wrecking ball, a whole crew, and you just shoved them down in here and you decided if I just ignore it, it'll go away. And it doesn't go away. And the next thing you know, the fear is creating hysteria in your life and you don't even know why. The bitterness is ruining your relationships with everybody you want to love but you can't because of the bitterness in your life is affecting every relationship you got. The sense of hopelessness is creating a cynical attitude in your life where you just, well, nothing really matters anyway. No one describes that activity as life. No one describes those emotions as life. Are you embracing the gospel? Are you embracing where life is actually found? Are you embracing the truth that Christ is alive? And if you're in Him, so will we. Are you embracing the truth that Jesus is returning? And if you're in Him, He's returning for you. For you. Are you embracing the reality, no matter how jacked up this world is, no matter how many disappointments we have, if we're in Christ, we have eternal life right here. So you missed an opportunity. You blew a chance to get a better job. You messed up a relationship. It hurts. It's wrong. You learn from it. But listen, you have a hope and a future forever. He's coming to make all things new. He is coming to restore all things. And so when Paul was writing to the church in Corinth, he said, listen, that means you can labor, you can walk, you can move, you can labor in Christ and know it's not in vain because He's coming back. The resurrection, 1 Corinthians 15, it is promised, it is real, we have a hope. And so in the face of death, we can march and we can live. And I can put a smile on my face, not from suppression, but because I got something to smile about. Jesus is real, life is eternal, and I've got a hope and a future. I've always got something to smile about if I choose to cling to the gospel. Amen? So wherever, if you're here tonight in the auditorium or over in Kids Zone or you're listening online, if you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you don't have anything to cling to. I'm not trying to be fire and brimstone, but the next 2 weeks are going to be a little fire and brimstone. If you don't have Jesus, you have nothing to cling to. And when the door opens for death, you will fall. But those who are in Christ will soar on eagle's wings. Amen. If you've never given your life to Jesus, I'm not trying to scare you to Him. I'm just trying to get the reality that if you've never given your life to Christ, that's the reality. You have the opportunity right now, just like everyone else in the world, you have the opportunity right now to choose to believe that He is God, that He died on the cross, that He paid the penalty of your sins, that He loves you, and that if you will commit your life to Him, He will commit His life to you, and He will never, ever break that commitment. So listen, if you want to know more about giving your life to Christ or walk with Him, there's no conversation. We'd love to have more than that. Put something in the message notes, things down there. Send us an email if you're here tonight. I'm going to be hanging out in our guest services area. Jonathan will be in our Next Steps room. If you want somewhere private to just pray and You can't miss it. We stopped using it when COVID hit, and now we're gonna unstop using it and bring it back. If you're here tonight and you're walking through life bearing that burden, you need somebody to pray with you, we want to encourage one another with these words. Amen. But you gotta take that step. If you're online, you gotta let us know. Lord, I pray, Father, as the band sings one last song, I pray that we don't just listen to it for its musical appeal to our hearts, but that we would listen to this for the truth that music is communicating to our hearts. May we be encouraged by the gospel and embrace it with everything we have. In Christ's name.
Revival, pour it out, pour it out. of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble, hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God of revival, pour it out, pour it out.